In notebook one, entry 292 and 293, St. Faustina teaches us a valuable lesson. She begins in 292, "When a soul loves God sincerely, it ought not fear anything in the spiritual life. Let it subject itself to the action of grace, and let it not impose any restraints on itself in communion with God. When Jesus ravished me by his beauty and drew me to himself, I then saw what in my soul was displeasing to him, and made up my mind to remove it, cost what it may. And aided by the grace of God, I did remove it at once. The magnanimity pleased the Lord, and from that moment, God started granting me higher graces. In my interior life, I never reason. I do not analyze the ways in which God's Spirit leads me. It is enough for me to know that I am loved and that I love. Pure love enables me to know God and to understand many mysteries. My confessor is an oracle for me. His word is sacred to me. I am speaking about my spiritual director, Father Sapochko." The Lord responds in 294 beautifully. But before I share that with you, I think it's imperative that we just take a look at a few really massive points here that would otherwise just kind of get, you know, smoothed in with the weight of things here. When a soul loves God sincerely, it ought not fear anything in the spiritual life. No matter what you're going through spiritually, the highs or the lows or just the regular, everyday, anything, it's to walk in the peace of Christ with the fullest confidence, is what she's saying here. The fullest confidence, the fullest trust in the image of divine mercy. In Italian, it says, Gesù confide in te. Confide is like confidence, but is the same for trust, ufantobia in Polish. But it's having that total trust that Christ is with you, that you are walking with him, and that spiritually he's giving you what he wants, or he's allowing what he deems necessary. And so it's having that trust, never abandoning you, but having that trust that he's going to take you through it. He'll give you what you need. He'll give you enlightenment to it if your heart is at peace and open to it. She explains, and this is very true, when there is an intimacy with God, when we are, no matter what's going on in our life, but when we are, when there is that desire, like Father was talking about, to do God's will, to know his will, he does everything with that. We're going to fall. We're going to fall short of it. We're undeserving of it. It's all that stuff. Yep, it's there. It's the truth. But that's not the focus for God. His focus is that we have the desire, because it will click. Eventually, if we have that desire and we keep trying like St. Faustina, it's going to click. It's going to happen. The grace will come. The flesh, the spirit, the soul, everything. It's got to get working together. It has to have that that special grace, if you will, from God. It takes time. Sometimes it's instantaneously, but most times it takes time. And just that sometimes repeating things. God does a lot in that time. He does not expect, unless it's his divine will, that something is immediately changed. He doesn't expect that from us. He expects that it's a work in progress. And and we should have peace in that. As irritated as it makes us sometimes, right? Because we want to be virtuous. We want it now. It doesn't happen that way. Oftentimes that virtue comes through suffering. Practicing patience, that bad word, you know? How do you get that? It's a lot of situations that will cause us or give us opportunities to either lose our self, lose our temper, lose our cool, whatever you want to call it, or to practice the virtue of patience and just allowing God to work in us. When she was drawn to Christ so intimately, and it happens in many different forms for people. For here, it may be something very supernatural that God drew her to himself. It can happen at Holy Communion time. It can happen right after receiving Holy Communion, Jesus, that intimate moment. It can happen in our prayer time. Don't discount that. And she talks about that. In the interior, okay, so she's saying that once she was drawn into that intimacy with Christ, she became very aware of an imperfection. And so she just wanted it gone at all costs. And she made God to know that she wanted this gone. She was going to do whatever it cost, to have this away from her, the sin or lack of, you know, who knows whatever this imperfection was. And once God saw that, she was working so hard on it, and it was gone by his grace, it was gone, no longer there, he started to grant her even higher graces. This is the spiritual life. This is the meat of the spiritual life. When we are, by God's grace, able to overcome because of our desire and our, you know, the will taking over the flesh of, I will not give in to anger at this moment. I will not walk away from God right now because of the death of my son or my daughter or my husband walking out on me or my wife leaving me or the abuse of whatever situation. Not being angry and walking away from God, but I will, by God's grace, not give in to anger or whatever the case may be. This caused God to be very pleased with her and to give her even higher graces. And that's a whole nother talk, higher graces. I do not analyze, she said, the ways in which God's Spirit leads me. How many times do you pick your own self apart? How many times you just pick and pick and pick at yourself? This can't be from God. I'm not good at this. Just, I'm terrible. Look what I did yesterday. Look what I said. How did I fall short? And, you know, pick away and pick away and pick at you until there's nothing left. Until the desire is gone, right? And say, yeah, but I know, but God knows I love him, and I know God loves me. I am going to overcome this one day. It may not be today. It may be 5 years from now. It may be tomorrow. We don't know. She's saying, I do not analyze the ways in which God's Spirit is leading me. She's trusting that he's leading her. And so however that happens, she's surrendering to those moments, to those times, and giving her best and by way of desire. She's letting God work in her, his way. She's not going to think. And that is a massive stumbling block for so many people. I think they've got it under control. I have figured God out. Now I know. And boy, when those people fall, ugh, when we fall, because we think we know what God is doing. We don't even have a clue. So often it does not make sense as we are going through different things. But he He leads us, and He promises us He will be the light. He will put a light on our path. It may not be for a whole mile. It might just be for three steps further. But if we are leading that sacramental life, and if we have that desire, that's it. He takes over. Jesus responds to St. Faustina. Act like a beggar who does not back away when he gets more alms than what he asks for, but offers thanks more fervently. Let's just think about that for a minute. I can totally relate to this because I beg all the time. I hate begging. I can't stand it. Asking, begging, I hate it. But it's part of what I have to do. And I can do it well. I can do it very well because I don't beg for myself. I do it for the Lord. I do it for the betterment of the ministry or for the beauty of the ministry or whatever I'm begging for. When I ask or when I beg, and he used the word beggar here, so there's a reason why. When I beg and I receive more than what I have asked for, what I have begged for, it oftentimes causes me to step back. Literally, I have to step back and say, what happens? What's happening? Right? It's like I asked for this and I got way more. I know God is working in a situation. I call that like a God moment, right? In that moment, because I only said this, I'm just going to say for money, you know what I mean? Because I'm always begging for money. So, and everybody hates that. Does anybody like begging for money? No. It's like the raunchiest job. So I'm just going to say, so I ask for $500 and somebody gives me like $2,000. It causes me to, you know, step back because it's like, this is a God moment. Obviously, God knows something I don't, and obviously, God is doing something in this person, and it tickles my spirit to think, what is God doing with this person right now that caused that person such joy? Oftentimes, it's a thanksgiving for favors answered from God. Oftentimes, it's a situation where that person has been in my shoes, maybe a totally different circumstance, but has received, and it's just, it's a God moment. Do you know what I'm talking about? Mm-hmm. Yeah, like a super abundance. And it could be, you know, anything. You ask for something and it comes back tenfold, or prayer is answered massively. So what he's saying here is, but offer thanks more fervently. And it's like, it's so true. It's so awesome once you catch your breath in that moment. It's like you just, don't you have like the whole day or a week or whatever long in just thanking God and thanking Him and thanking Him? And it's like, you know, I can't believe it. This is the way of God. And when these spiritual things happen, same thing, better, greater. You too should not back away and say that you are not worthy of receiving greater graces when I give them to you. So often, when good things do happen, we think about how unworthy we are. But we have little minds compared to the mind of God. And we look at, like, little children, right? They get an upset, or they, you know, purposely do something that's upsetting to the parent, and then the parent reprimands a child, disciplines, and, you know, it recognizes, and then it's, like, hesitant. Your heart overflows with love for the child because, you know, it's a child. You can't help but, and so it is even a billion times greater with God. And all I want that kid to do is behave, you know? Just be and don't do that bad thing again, or don't, whatever it is. And so it's with God. Don't waste time. It's like, don't waste time. Don't waste time on what you aren't, or what you don't have yet, or it's, I trust. I know that whatever the circumstances, God is going to work in me. That's the mindset he wants us to have. God is working in me. Say that with me. God is working in me. Say it again. God is working in me. Say it again. God is working in me. Hold on to that and repeat that as many times as your brain and your ear need to hear it till it reaches the soul. God is working in me. I know you are unworthy, but rejoice all the more and take as many treasures from my heart as you can carry, for then you will please me more. One of the silliest things I ever hear people say is, oh, no, no, you don't have to pray for me. Pray for my friend. Oh, no. Don't pray for me. That person. Pray for that person. That's a good person. You know? It's like, well, what are you, garbage? Don't you want grace? Jesus is saying right here, take as much from my heart as you can possibly hold. Just keep taking and taking and taking. Oh, I can't ask God for that. Too much. He answered my prayer, so I can't ask him for this too. It's like, what are you thinking? What could you possibly get from God's heart that you don't need, or I don't need, right? Till we take our last breath, we will never have enough. And all things that come from God, from his heart, is only going to make us better in every possible way. Keep asking. Keep asking. Don't be afraid to ask. And if it doesn't make sense to you, keep asking. It's his problem. He's got to figure things out. You just have to keep on breathing and walking. The rest is in God's hands. Everything is in his hands. And I will tell you one more thing. Isn't that cool? And also, it's like mom, right? And one more thing, right? I will tell you one more thing. Take these graces not only for yourself, but for others. That is, encouraging the souls with whom you come in contact to trust in my infinite mercy. Oh, how I love those souls who have complete confidence in me. I will do everything for them. Now, this is loaded. This should give you a grace, an opening in that spiritual realm of the mind, the heart, to know of the power that you have by God's grace to do good, to bless others. It should open the eye of the soul to the power of prayer and offering and having confidence, he says. The more you have confidence in me, oh, how I love that soul. I will do everything for them. Line your mind up with God's speech. I will do everything with them, for them. What he's saying is, by you having confidence, everything that needs to be accomplished in our lifetime, he will accomplish in us. He will give us everything we need. Don't try to figure God out, because we don't even know tomorrow. He does. He knows exactly what we're going to need 3 weeks and 21 days from today. Don't try to figure him out. He promises that if we trust him, if we walk peacefully with him, no matter what is going around, he will give us what we need. Great, great opportunities for his blessings in a deep relationship, an intimate relationship with Christ. I pray for you, and I ask you to pray for me, because I need it too. And oh yeah, I want all the prayers I can get. I'm trusting. I pray for our families. I need prayer as well. The families that we were born into, and the families that we have here in the world. We're all children of God. Recognize God is working in you. God is working in you. Recognize the power by the grace of God that you have in your prayer. May God bless all of us and our families. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.